You're entering a world where logic and insanity are one and the same. A world of puppets and animation, with musical numbers that come out of nowhere. A world at home both on stage and on screen. A world comprised of visual brilliance, but also things that make you say, "What the hell was that?" This is a world of creative insanity and insane creativity. This is the Tamor Zone. As you've guessed from the opening, Julie Taymor is not your average director. Not only is she at home on both the stage and screen, her unique creative style has garnered her a reputation for being one of the few true auteurs living today.
So, what makes an auteur? Well, according to Andrew Saris, there are two components to a true auteur. The first is about how an auteur's work will stand apart as a unique creation with the director's personal style immediately recognizable. No matter what the auteur creates, their work will be distinguishable as their own. The other characteristic Saris applies to a true auteur is an understanding, or goal of understanding, the interior meaning of art and how cinema functions as art. Julie Taymor is a director who, both on stage and on screen, for better or worse, puts her stamp on her projects, and is probably one of the most passionate people I've ever seen when she talks about her work. Just watch any interview. She is 100% devoted to every project she does, and has reasons behind every artistic choice.
As a child, Taymor got into theater early, joining the Boston Children's Theater at age 10. As she grew up and went to college for mythology and folklore, her work moved behind the curtain and camera as she directed several productions, honing her uniquely bizarre visual style. From these early works, a few common threads start to appear. First is her prolific use of puppetry. And not just hand puppets. Full-body, multi-person puppets. This use of the medium would even win her two grants from the Henson Foundation. And then there's the abstract surrealism. This goes hand in hand with the puppet use because she never really tries to hide the puppeteer. There's always a level of suspension of disbelief which Taymor has often said is a key element in the theater. As she said in a 1983 interview, if theater is going to survive, it has to do what it does best. What it does best is the non-literal. Film and television have virtually co-opted naturalism. To compete, theater must be more theatrical. I love her point of view on this, and I think some Broadway shows should take those words to heart. Theater can't recreate what's on the screen, so why not try something completely different? Speaking of, let's dive right into her work in the theater. Given the time limit I have, I cannot even begin to talk about the many productions Taymor has helmed over the years. But I will say, I wish I had been there because this imagery is absolutely incredible. So, for time's sake, let's jump a little ahead in her career to what became her biggest production to date. Now, here's the thing about The Lion King. It should not work. A giant, family-friendly, mainstream company like Disney teaming up with an auteur of the stage who specializes in bizarre and often creepy imagery? When Taymor was approached to direct the second stage adaptation for a Disney film, she was very skeptical. Would her imagery and creative vision meld with a company like Disney? Turns out, really well. But only because it's not a Disney production. It's a Taymor production. When you look at all the other Broadway adaptations of Disney films, all of them are immediately recognizable what they're based on. Every show recreates the look of the film on the stage because that's what adaptations are supposed to do, right? Well, not The Lion King. Aside from the comic relief characters, Zazu, Timon, Pumbaa, and the three main hyenas, every character design is completely original with no clear connection to the film apart from the species. And that's a good thing. Want to know why Disney productions last maybe 5 years on Broadway? It's because there's not much new to see. They're just trying to put the film on stage, which Taymor knows does not work. As someone with a not-Broadway-friendly bank account, my main way of seeing productions is through slime tutorials. And despite some interesting effects in Aladdin and Frozen, they are just trying to recreate the look of the film and don't do it as well as the film. I'd rather just watch the original animation than some effects on a screen in the background. Don't get me wrong, I know it would be better live, but I'm not really desperate for a ticket. Lion King cannot be viewed through a bootleg. The spectacle of the production simply does not translate through a screen, and it shouldn't. It was built to be a live spectacle, and that's what it is. Because the Lion King musical is its own spectacle, separate from the film.
These other productions are very nice, but their main appeal is the connection to the original film. And that is the reason why the highest grossing Lion King product is not the animated film, not that piece of shit remake. It's the musical directed by Julie Taymor with a worldwide lifetime gross of $8.2 billion. While I'm not going to go into her work with Shakespeare here, as that would take up at least another 30 minutes, I did want to bring up this 2014 filmed production of A Midsummer Night's Dream, just because it shows how well Taymor can elevate the material she is given just through her direction and visual style. The use of aerial acrobatics and a contortionist actress playing Puck adds otherworldly layers to the character I've never seen before. Every scene involving the magic of the fairies is elevated through the simple yet incredibly beautiful visual design. But it's not only the gorgeous visuals that elevate the written material, it's also the added visual humor. While Taymor's films usually have some funny moments, this was the first time I'd seen her go all out with hilarious slapstick and many sexual innuendos that were definitely not in the original play. This scene between the four main lovers is already one of the funniest in the show, just as written, but her addition of intense physicality, pillow fights, and all the characters eventually stripping down to their underwear just adds so much humor. Seriously, if you haven't seen this, it's free online, and I highly recommend you give it a watch. You will be laughing your ass off. But that's just her work on the stage. What about her work on the screen? Let's move forward a couple more years to what many consider Taymor's best film, Frida. Ay, qué bonito es volar. While Frida and Taymor seem like a match made in heaven, Taymor was actually a late addition to the production. Star Selma Hayek was the one who gathered most of the supporting cast, including Alfred Molina and Ashley Judd. The script was also already completed by the time it was sent to Taymor, and she described it as one of the best scripts she had ever read. And in my opinion, it was a perfect fit. While the dialogue moments are very well written, the amount of visual storytelling packed into every frame of this film is incredible, and is the perfect representation of the saying, a picture is worth a thousand words. The existing paintings clearly already have a meaning behind them, but I was not really aware of that before the film, and now I think I've got a pretty good understanding, and not because of the dialogue. As Taymor stated, what is different about Frida is that her paintings are autobiographical. In every film commentary and interview, Taymor has expressed how important the why behind art is. Whenever she talks about her film scenes, there is always a very specific artistic reason behind every visual element. This is why Taymor was so drawn to Frida and what she saw as the most important aspect of the film, showing visually why Frida painted what she did. There is never any dialogue explaining the reason behind Frida's paintings. No long monologues about the deeper, painful meaning. Something happens in Frida's life. A brief artistic montage happens, often involving animation, ending with a completed painting. Without dialogue, without any wordy explanation, the audience immediately understands the meaning behind the painting. Now, Frida and Taymor seemed like a match made in heaven. Both are artists with focuses in surrealism, and the melding of styles worked perfectly. That is not what I thought when I heard about her most recent biopic, The Glorias, based on the life of activist Gloria Steinem. Gloria Steinem, for those who don't know, is a journalist and prominent figure in second wave feminism. So obviously, let's get the director of Titus. Well, sometimes opposites attract. And in this case, what I thought would be a clashing of style and subject matter worked very well. Most of the time, but we'll get there. Unlike with Frida, Taymor is the writer, director, and producer of The Glorias, and while the film is more accessible than her early, more abstract work, it is still clear that this film is not interested in being a standard biopic to be lumped in with 100 others Hollywood pumps out every year. To start, the film utilizes a unique framing device of a bus carrying the four versions of Gloria at different stages of her life to an unknown destination. Not only does this add a unique beginning and end, which we'll get into shortly, but throughout the film, the different versions of Gloria interact, showing how she changed as a person over the years. My two favorite uses of this device both involve the oldest Gloria interacting with younger versions. The first is used as a representation of hindsight when the third Gloria experiences blatant sexism and the fourth Gloria speaks for her in a clever comeback.
Do you know, Mr. Bella, that every year there's a pretty girl who comes to New York and pretends to be a writer before she gets married? Well, Gloria is this year's pretty girl.
You know what? You can say what you want, but some of us are actually becoming the men we thought we wanted to marry.
The third Gloria is frustrated that in the actual moment, she said nothing, and the fourth Gloria assures her that in the future, she will. My other favorite moment isn't technically on the bus, but it is still two time periods coming together as the fourth Gloria interviews the second Gloria about what she wants to be when she grows up. The second Gloria replies with a very typical 1950s housewife answer, not reflecting at all the views she would grow to have.
When I grow up, I'm going to go to Hollywood. And then I'm going to get married and settle down and have three kids.
Something I find a bit grating in many biopics is how the main character is portrayed as being destined for something or has always been the person they grow into. This interview shows that Gloria was not always the same person throughout her life, and at points, her values directly contradicted with each other. That's what the film is about, the journey through life, which is where the ending comes in. The film makes several time jumps from the 90s to the early 2000s, skimming through the later years of Steinem's life, and comes to a stop in late 2016, as the fourth Gloria writes about the outcome of the presidential election.
Yet I know that in the future, Hillary's loss will be part of our victories. Because the path up is always a jagged line, not a straight one. Our victory is not a one-person marathon, but a relay race.
The film cuts back to the bus, where the two youngest Glorias notice how they've passed the exit sign for Washington, D.C. a gazillion times before. Slowly, the camera pulls back into the walkway and moves towards the front of the bus, revealing the many new women wearing pink hats sitting on the bus with the other Glorias, and finally ending on the real Gloria Steinem sitting in the front. From here, the film shows footage from Steinem's speech at the Women's March in 2017. In this speech, Steinem speaks on what she has learned through her many years of life, and how, despite the recent setbacks, the women's movement has gained so much progress since it began, and that the amount of support this one march has gotten worldwide shows the movement for women's rights is far from over. It is just ramping up for another wave.
This is an outpouring of energy and true democracy like I have never seen in my very long life. It is wide in age, it is deep in diversity, and remember, the Constitution does not begin with I, the President, it begins with we, the people.
Despite a few odd choices for the film's resident Penny Arcade Nightmare, I think The Glorias is Taymor's best feature film since Frida. Which is why it's so disappointing that it flew so far under the radar during its direct-to-streaming release in late 2020. The reviews from critics as well I don't think reflect the quality of the film, as it's not only mainstream accessible, but a rare example of a biopic done outside the traditional Hollywood formula. Julie Taymor is a true auteur. Her films and productions may not always make sense or translate well to audiences, but she always puts 100% of herself into every project. Even in those films I don't really like, there's always something amazing. I didn't really get into Across the Universe, but I have watched the I Want You, She's So Heavy sequence dozens of times, and I stand by it's one of the most creative and clever representations of that time in US history. Is her stuff weird? Yes. Is it always good? No. But for good reason. The creative risks Taymor takes in every one of her projects are risks not many directors would be as courageous to take. She would rather go all out and fail spectacularly than play it safe and be passively marketable. And for my money, the risks that do pay off are worth tenfold all the ones that don't. So, from one weirdo to another, keep doing what you're doing, Julie. I can't wait to see what comes next.